Third lecture of LiveLaw's practitioner series, which is today on burden of proof, a topic from law of evidence. Today we have with us Justice Abraham Mathew, who's a former judge of Kerala High Court and a very well-known expert in criminal law, especially in Evidence Act. Sir was also former the director of Kerala Judicial Academy. So without wasting time, I'm switching it to Sir. Before switching to Sir, I would like to request our attendees to kindly post their questions in the Q&A box. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. Good evening to each and everyone. Today's topic is burden of proof. Nobody likes this burden. When a party approaches an advocate to file a suit or initiate other legal proceedings, the first thing that should occur to his mind is, on whom the burden lies, what facts his party should prove, what facts his party need not prove, what facts the other side should prove, what fact the other side need not prove. Then only he can give proper legal advice, he can file a suit in the manner it is expected to be filed. The obligation to adduce evidence is called the burden of proof. It is used in two senses in the Indian Evidence Act. First, the privilege or the duty to start adducing evidence. The second, the obligation to introduce evidence. So a distinction has been made between these two things by calling these terms, the first situation as burden of proof and the other one onus of proof. But the words, the terms mean the same thing. It is burden. The burden to start. The party on whom the burden lies to start adducing evidence is said to be the party who should establish the case. So in textbooks, you can see the term used is who should establish the case. That is determined on the basis of the records produced by the court. Before the court. In civil cases, the burden of proof is determined, or the burden of proof to establish a case is determined on the basis of pleadings, documents, answers to interrogatories, etc., etc. This is called burden on the pleadings. On the other hand, in criminal cases, the burden to prove existence of every ingredient of the offense is on the prosecution. So this is the initial burden. The burden to establish a case is called the initial burden. It is the burden to start adducing evidence. Who should start adducing evidence? The two sections in the Evidence Act which are relevant for us are sections 101 and 102. 101 says, whoever desires any court to give judgment as to any legal right or liability dependent on the existence of facts which he asserts must prove that those facts exist. When a person is bound to prove the existence of any facts, it is said that the burden of proof lies on that person. So it is applicable equally to civil cases and criminal cases, which can be understood from the terms legal rights or liability. Now we come to section 102. 102 says that the burden of proof in a suit or proceedings lies on that person who would fail if no evidence at all were adduced on either side. We can say that section 101 contains the principle and section 102 contains the test. The test is not whether who would succeed, but who would fail if no evidence were adduced on either side. It is an imaginary situation. If no evidence is adduced on either side in a particular case, who would fail? That is the test given in section 102. We can have certain illustrations in this matter. The plaintiff sues the defendant for a recovery of money lent. The defendant denies the transaction. So if the plaintiff does not adduce any evidence, the defendant need not adduce any evidence. So who would fail if no evidence were adduced on either side? The plaintiff would fail. So the burden on the pleadings lies on the plaintiff in this case. Two, the plaintiff is defendant for recovery of money lent. The defendant admits the loan, the transaction, but his contention is that he repaid the amount. Here, in his return statement, the defendant admits the transaction. A fact admitted need not be proved. So the plaintiff need not adduce any evidence to prove the transaction. The case of the defendant is that he repaid the amount. So if he does not prove repayment, he would fail. So that means he has to start adducing evidence. The burden on the pleadings lies on the defendant in this case. Now, another illustration. The plaintiff prays for partition of the properties which belong to his father. He asserts that the father died intestate. The defendant, who is his brother, appears and contends that the properties were bequeathed to him by a will executed by his father. Here, the defendant admits that the plaintiff and himself are children of a particular person, and he died, and the properties belong to him. So all these facts need not be proved by the plaintiff. The defendant has set up a will. If the will is not proved, he would fail. A decree for partition will be passed by the court. So here the initial burden to start adducing evidence is on the defendant. So burden on the pleadings lies on him. This is actually what called the burden on the pleadings. Now, another illustration also we can consider. The plaintiff prays for recovery of immovable property from the defendant on the basis of his title. The defendant contests that he is not a trespasser, but a lessee of the defendant. Here, the burden is on the defendant because the defendant admits title of the plaintiff to the property. But his contention is that he is not liable to be evicted because he is a lessee of the property. So unless he proves that he is a lessee of the property, he would fail. The suit would be decreed. Here also, the burden is on the plaintiff. He has to start evidence. And this is reflected in Order 18, Rule 1, CPC. We can just, I shall just read this Order 18, Rule 1, CPC. Right to begin. The plaintiff has the right to begin unless the defendant admits the facts alleged by the plaintiff and contends that either in point of law or on some other additional facts alleged by the defendant, the plaintiff is not entitled to any part of the relief which he seeks, in which the case the defendant has the right to begin. The right is equal to duty also. He has a duty to begin. Now, there may be cases in which the burden to prove some of the issues on one party and the burden to prove other issues is on the other party. This is also taken care of by the CPC. Order 18, Rule 3 says, where there are several issues, the burden of proving some of which lies on the other party, the party beginning may, at his option, either produce his evidence on those issues or reserve it by way of answer to the evidence produced by the other party. And in the latter case, the party beginning may produce evidence on the issues after the other party has produced all his evidence, and the other party may then reply specially on the evidence so produced by the party beginning, but the party beginning will then be entitled to reply generally on the whole case. So these two situations are taken care of by CPC also. Now, in a civil suit, the burden is fixed once the pleadings are complete. So the burden is fixed on the basis of the pleadings as well as the documents and other materials, that is the interrogatories to answers to interrogatories. And once it is fixed, it never shifts. So that is the first thing we have to bear in mind. In a civil suit, once the burden is fixed, that means the initial burden. In other words, the burden on the pleadings is fixed, then it never shifts. It lasts till the end of the proceedings. On the other hand, in criminal cases, we know that there may not be any pleadings. The police will file a report, a final report, and in the case of complaint case, there will be a complaint. And there is no question of any pleadings or any material by the defendant, the accused. The accused cannot even produce a document because that is not the stage at which he can produce. So it is well established that in criminal cases, the burden to establish the case, that is the initial burden, that is the burden to start adducing evidence, is always on the prosecution. Whatever may be the statutory provisions relating to the burden of proof says, 2009, 15 SEC, 200. So in civil cases, the burden may be either on one party or the other party. In criminal cases, it can never be on the accused. It is always on the prosecution, whatever may be the statutory provision relating to the burden of proof says. Okay. Now, burden to introduce evidence. We have seen that the first part is the burden on the pleadings. The second is the burden to introduce evidence. This is a different concept. This becomes applicable in the course of the trial. And unlike the burden on the pleadings, or the burden to establish the case, or the initial burden, this burden to introduce evidence shifts, may shift constantly or continually. We can have an illustration. A bank officer, a bank files a suit for recovery of money from the defendant. And the bank relies on a revival letter, that is an acknowledgement, to prove that the defendant acknowledged debt within the period of limitation. Otherwise, the suit is a time barred. The defendant borrower denies its execution. The bank officer deposes that on 1-1-2008, say 1-1-2018, the defendant came to his office at Ernakulam and signed the document, executed the document at 11 a.m. The onus is now on the defendant to rebut it because his evidence shows that the defendant appeared before him or came to his office and executed the document. Unless it is rebutted, unless it is disproved, the acknowledgement will be held to be a valid one. But in the evidence, the defendant deposes that or produces a document proving that on 1-1-2008, the date of the document, he was being treated as an inpatient in a hospital at Thrissur, about 75 or 80 kilometers from Ernakulam, where the office of the bank is situated. Now the onus is shifted to the bank because here is an evidence showing that the defendant was being treated as an inpatient at a hospital far away from the bank office. But in the cross-examination, the defendant admits that on that particular date, he went out of the hospital with the permission of the doctor. Now, the onus is shifted. The onus is shifted to the defendant to prove that he did not go to Ernakulam. The defendant gets the gate pass of the hospital proved to the gatekeeper, and it proves that he went out of the hospital at 10:30 a.m. and came back at 10:45 a.m. That means he was outside the hospital only for 10 minutes. Now, it means that it was impossible for him to reach Ernakulam and sign the document at the office of the bank. Again, onus is shifted to the other side. So the bank has to prove that he came there at that particular time. And if there is no evidence to disprove it, then the bank's case will fall. So this is actually called shifting of onus. Shifting of onus. And the burden of proof or the initial burden, the burden on the pleadings disappears in the course of the trial in many cases. So it has no relevance at all after the evidence is recorded. It only determines, or it is relevant only to say, who should adduce evidence first. Thereafter, it disappears except in some cases, or it becomes significant only in some cases. Such cases are cases where the evidence is equally balanced and it's difficult for the court to take a decision on the in the case. Then the burden, the initial burden, the burden on the pleadings assumes significance. That is AER 1949 Privy Council, AER 1949 Privy Council 278. You may also go through AER 1959 Supreme Court 31. Sometimes a party may be bound to prove certain negative facts. And what about the burden in such cases where negative facts are to be proved to entitle the party to get the relief or to fix the liability on the other side? The general principle is that the issue must be proved by the party who states an affirmative, not by a party who states a negative. There are two grounds for it. One is fairness. The second is the practical difficulty in proving a negative. Negative. So take a case. A lady was found practicing law. And it was alleged that she was practicing law without LLB degree or without obtaining a certificate from the Bar Council. She was not enrolled. So a case was registered. And when it comes to trial, can the prosecutor say that? What we say is that she does not have, or she did not have enrollment or LLB degree. So she asserts that she has LLB degree or she was enrolled. So positive evidence should be there to prove her enrollment or having passed this LLB degree. So the burden is on the accused to prove it. Can the prosecutor say so? Another case is a person was found traveling on a train without a ticket, ticketless traveler. And the case reached the court. Can the prosecutor say that? The burden is on the accused to prove that he had a certificate, because that is an affirmative fact. And the prosecutor is not bound to prove non-existence of something. See, in criminal cases, we know the burden never shifts. We have already seen that was the universal rule. But what the prosecutor can do when the issue to be proved or the fact to be proved is a negative one? The answer is this. The issues which is negative in form may be affirmative in substance. Or what is negative in language may be affirmative in law. 1991 1 KLT 861. 1991 2 KLT 628. I think there is no Supreme Court decision on this point. So how can it be done? Every day we do it in almost all criminal cases or criminal courts. Take the case of 304 IPC. What is to be proved? The accused did not take care. That is negligence or recklessness. It's a negative fact. Then how can it be proved? Still the prosecutors approve it. So take the case, the first case where a lady was found practicing law without enrollment or LLB degree. The initial burden lies on the prosecutor. And what he has to prove is that the lady did not have enrollment. How can it be done? The police officer who wanted her to produce the enrollment certificate or the LLB certificate should first enter the witness box and depose that I found her practicing law. She has filed a wakala, appeared before the court, and I asked her to produce her LLB degree certificate or the enrollment certificate, and she did not produce it. The initial burden is disturbed. See, though it is a negative fact, see how it is proved. Coming to this second one, that is a ticketless traveler, only three sentences are necessary. The person who should be examined is the ticket examiner. The ticket examiner should enter the witness box and depose that I found this person traveling on the train. I demanded him to produce the ticket. He did not produce. These three sentences are sufficient to discharge the initial burden lying on the prosecution. So that is sufficient. So even if it is a negative fact, or appears to be a negative fact, it can be proved because in substance it is affirmative. So in the case of 304A also, this is the thing, this is what is done every day in our courts. It is done by adducing positive evidence. Now, we have seen that.
Sir, without interruption, good evening, sir. Very good evening. I just joined late. I was in court. I just rushed. So, sir, there is one Supreme Court decision. Yes. C.A. Akbar versus State of Karnataka. That is AR 1979, Supreme Court 1848.
Yes.
And and connected to that, there is a live wire was hanging from an electric pole. It was lying there.
Rasib Salukitam.
Yes.
It is applicable in criminal courts also.
Yes, sir. The Supreme Court only said that you have to prove. Prosecution has to prove that the live wire was there.
Rasib Salukitam rightly said.
I'll
be referring to it later in another.
Yes, sir.
Now, this burden may be shifted. The burden may be shifted because of certain statutory provisions. These statutory provisions are presumptions. Presumption is the inference of existence of a fact or proof of existence of another fact. This is true in the case of presumption of law and presumption of fact. There cannot be any dispute. So a presumption can arise only on proof of another fact. The second mentioned fact is called foundational fact. Presumption is an inference the court is directed to draw, or the court may draw from a proved or admitted fact, or from certain state of affairs. And presumption cannot arise from another presumption, but only from facts. It means that there cannot be double presumption. 1998 7 SEC 337, AR 2004 Supreme Court 960, in AR 2001 Supreme Court 318, AR 2001 Supreme Court 318, the Supreme Court observed that a presumption cannot arise from another presumption unless there is a statutory compulsion. But I have not come across any such statutory compulsion. I don't know whether Mr. Harindranath has come across it, whether a presumption can arise from another presumption. Anyway, the fundamental law is that a presumption can arise only from a fact, either proved or admitted. I have not come across any situation where a presumption can arise from another presumption. But the Supreme Court has said that unless there is a statutory provision, I don't know, I have not come across any situation. Another decision is 2006, 6 SEC 39. So the significance of presumption is that it shifts the burden. That means the party in whose favor there is a presumption need not adduce evidence to prove that particular fact. That's all. So it shifts the burden. That is its significance. It may be classified. Presumptions may be classified. Presumptions of law, presumption of fact, mixed presumptions. Then rebuttable and irrebuttable presumptions. Section 41 Evidence Act says about this conclusive data. Then it may be partially rebuttable presumption, like section 112, non-access. There is an exception to it. That is 112, partially rebuttable one. So the presumption, classification, etc., are discussed in AR 1979, Supreme Court 1848, which Mr. Harindranath just now mentioned. The meaning of presumption is given in 2009, Volume 2, SEC 513. So what is necessary to raise a presumption is that proof of a fact, from which only a presumption can arise. We can easily understand it. If we go to this Mahabharata, there was a Malsya kingdom, king, and it was the Virat, King Virat, and Kitaka was the commander-in-chief of that king, Virat. So the Pandavas were living in anonymity there. This Kitak was a very strong man. It was difficult to overpower him by anyone, but he cast his eyes on Draupadi. And the Pandavas could not tolerate it. So ultimately what happened is that the Kauravas heard that this Kitak is killed. Then the Pandavas say, Chattad Kitakanengil Konnad Bhiman. If Kitaka is killed, then the murderer can only be the Pandavas. So
one addition. It is said by the Kauravas because they came across the news that Kijaga is dead.
Yes.
And then they said that if Kijaga is killed, it can only be Bhima.
Right. It is a slip of the tongue. It is a slip of the tongue. Kauravas said that Kijaga nengil konnad Bhiman. If Kijaga is killed, then
it can only be Bhima.
It's the only murderer. Because he alone is able to overpower him. That is. So what is necessary to raise that presumption? There should be proof of death of Kijak. Unless death of Kijak is proved, there cannot be a presumption that it was Bhima. So that is called the foundational fact. So to raise a presumption, this foundational fact has to be proved. That is Nuraga case, 2008, 16 SEC, 417. There is a concept called a reverse burden. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You're very much audible.
Reverse burden. So what do you mean by reverse burden? You buy a car for what? You purchase a car for going forwards, not to go backwards. But when there is a reverse gear also, sometimes you have to go backwards. So the ordinary rule in civil cases is that the plaintiff should prove all the rights which constitute the bundle of rights which would entitle him to the relief. Or to get a degree. Example, in a suit for recovery of possession, of immovable property which the defendant allegedly trespassed into, the plaintiff must prove his title to the property to trespass by the defendant. Suppose he proves only the trespass and not the title, he will not be entitled to a decree. And he proves only his title and not trespass, then also he is not entitled to prove. So every right which forms the bundle of right has to be proved by the plaintiff. Then only he will get a decree. But the statute can create a presumption in his favor in respect of one of the rights. In respect of one of the rights. Take the case of a suit on demand promissory note. Demand promissory note. The plaintiff files a suit on demand promissory note for recovery of money from the defendant, which he allegedly borrowed from him. The plaintiff must prove payment of the consideration, execution of the promissory note, and failure of the defendant to repay the loan. So all these three things should be simultaneously proved to entitle to him a decree. But Section 118 small a provides that, NI Act provides that, Negotiable Instruments Act provides that, there is a presumption that every negotiable instrument was executed for consideration. So passing of consideration is presumed. So that means the plaintiff need not prove it. Once the plaintiff proves execution of the promissory note, the presumption arises. In criminal cases also, this reverse burden procedure is adopted by the legislature. In criminal cases, the prosecution has to prove every ingredient of the offense. Every ingredient. It is not sufficient for the prosecution to prove almost all the ingredients, but it must prove all the ingredients. That is, if there are five, they must prove the five ingredients also. Take the case of a person, the accused, the charge is that he voluntarily caused the grievous hurt by means of a deadly weapon. So the prosecution has to prove that it was voluntarily done, the grievous hurt was caused, deadly weapon was used, then only the liability will be fixed on the charge will be proved by the prosecution. If the prosecution fails to prove that it was a deadly weapon, then charge is not proved. Another offense comes in, 326 is not proved, grievous hurt not proved, 326 is not attracted, voluntarily, then no offense is made out. So all the ingredients should be proved by the prosecution. It cannot be heard to say that we have proved some of it, the other may be presumed. No, there is nothing like that. AER 1979 Supreme Court 1848, we have already seen. 79 Supreme Court 1848. Every ingredient should be proved by the prosecution. But statutes may can provide that existence of one or more ingredients of an offense may be presumed. There is no bar. There are several statutes which would provide that existence of some of the ingredients, one or several ingredients of the offense is presumed. The prosecution need not prove those ingredients then. Examples are Section 139 Negotiable Instrument Act, Section 28 POCSO, Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Act, Section 29 Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Act. This is done, or presumptions are devices. I have already mentioned it. Presumptions are devices by the use of which courts are enabled and entitled to pronounce on an issue, notwithstanding that there is no evidence or insufficient evidence. It may be affirmative or disaffirmative inference. That is the AER 2009 Supreme Court 1518. AER 2009 Supreme Court 1518, paracitation I have already given, 2009 to SEC. So the provisions creating presumptions are, as stated above, are called a reverse onus cross or a reverse legal burden. It shifts the burden to the accused to prove the absence of that fact. See, he has to prove absence of the fact, the existence of which is presumed by the statute. AR 1958, Supreme Court 61. We know that the universal law is that presumption of innocence is innocence of accused is presumed. Innocence of the accused is presumed. Then can a legislature say that a particular ingredient in offense is presumed? Existence of that particular ingredient is presumed. This was challenged. The constitutional validity of a reverse burden process was challenged in Nuraga case. That is 2008, 16 SEC 417. 417. The Supreme Court said that reverse burden processes are constitutionally valid. It is, they are not ultra vires the constitution. But the constitution, what the Supreme Court said is that the legislature can say that existence of one or more ingredients of the offense may be presumed. It did not say that all the existence of all the ingredients can be proved or may be presumed. It did not say so. Now we come to Section 28 of the Protection of Children of Sexual Offences Act. See, it's a very interesting provision. For the purposes of Section 28 of the Act, for the purposes of providing a speedy trial.
Sir, one second, sir. Could you give the citation of Nuraga's case?
Nuraga 2008, 16 SEC 417.
2008, 16 SEC 417.
Nuraga.
Thank you.
Okay. Now read Section 29 of POCSO, Protection of Children Sexual Offences Act. Where a person is prosecuted for committing or abetting or attempting to commit any offence under Sections 3, 5, 7 and Section 9 of this Act, the Special Court shall presume. See, mandatory, the Special Court shall presume that such person has committed or abetted or attempted to commit the offense, as the case may be, unless the contrary is proved. So that phrase is there. But what does it say? When a person is prosecuted for committing an offense, when does the prosecution start? When a person can be said to be prosecuted? At least when charge is framed. At least when charge is framed, forget this issuance of summons. Because we know a trial is not defined in the criminal procedure code. But it has several different meanings in the different context trial. Okay. But we cannot say that a person is prosecuted when a charge is framed. So the moment a charge is framed, can the prosecutor say that Section 29 presumes that the accused has committed the offense? That means the presumption is he is guilty. He has committed the offense means he is guilty. So it is for the accused to adduce evidence first to prove that he has not committed the offense. So wonderful provision. I think this is against Nuraga case. Nuraga case, it did not say, I have already told you that in Nuraga case, the Supreme Court has not said that the legislature can make a law to the effect that the ingredients of all the ingredients of an offense may be presumed. No. It says that one or several ingredients of offense may be presumed. But here, what the legislature has done, the parliament has said that once a person is prosecuted for the offense, there is a presumption that he is guilty. So the moment the charge is framed, can the prosecutor say that the presumption is that he is guilty, he must adduce evidence of first.
Sir, otherwise, one doubt.
Yes.
So without interruption, sir, one doubt. Sir, in this Nuraga's case, it was an Afghan guy came to India and spotted, But in that Supreme Court, Justice Sinha held that it is a human right, which cannot be equated to human right.
Not a fundamental right.
Not a fundamental right, but it is a human right. Nonetheless, it's a human right. So what is the constitutional contours of this human right and fundamental right?
Okay. Mr. Hari, see, presumption, the Supreme Court has said that presumption of innocence is a part of the protection given under Section 21.
Yes. Yes, sir.
How can it be said that it is only, it is not a fundamental right, it is only a natural right?
That is what is...
All natural rights are fundamental rights.
Yes, sir.
Because they are natural. You are getting it, it is not conferred on anyone. You have that because you are born as a human being. So all fundamental rights are natural rights. So we cannot say that it is not a fundamental right. It is a fundamental right.
In this context, could we say that the POCSO Act presumptions, which takes away our right of this presumption of innocence and other things, are constitutionally valid, sir? It's only my...
Yes.
Because there is no Supreme Court judgment on that point.
I doubt its validity. And its validity has been challenged in the Kerala High Court by Advocate Ralph.
Sir.
I think unless the court interprets the word prosecution as means that is the end of the trial,
yes,
it will be found out. If the court interprets that, here the prosecution means at the end of the trial. It can be understood like that only. Otherwise, it will be found out. Because there cannot be a presumption of guilt in any context. That is the decision I gave first, 2015 SEC, that whatever may be the wording in the statute, the burden never shifts in criminal cases. Yes, it is always on the prosecution. I have already given that. So the constitutional validity of this Section 29 is doubtful. Otherwise, the word prosecution should be interpreted in some other way.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Now we come to Section 29. 29 is already over. Now we come to how to discharge this burden. How to discharge this reverse burden. Ordinarily, the reverse burden clause would contain the phrase unless and until the contrary is proved. Section 29, we have seen, unless the contrary is proved. Unless the contrary, that phrase will be there in almost all these provisions. In Sanjay's case, the question of the means to prove this and means to discharge the reverse legal burden was considered by the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court. That is 2000. I shall give you that decision later. It's not mentioned here. Yes. Yes, I'll take it later. Yes. So the Constitution Bench held that it is sufficient for the defense to prove that it has a probable case. The burden to prove non-existence of the presumed fact is not as heavy as it is on the prosecution to prove its case. So there is, the burden is very light. The burden is very light. And in Nuraga case, already mentioned, this it was held that preponderance of probability is sufficient. Preponderance of probability is sufficient. So this is reiterated in 2015-17 SEC 554. But when we come to Section 30 of the POCSO, Protection of Children Offence, Sexual Offences Act, I shall read it. Presumption of culpable and mental state. Sorry, culpable mental state, mens rea. In any prosecution for any offence under this Act, which requires a culpable mental state on the part of the accused, the special court shall presume existence of such mental state, but it shall be a defense for the accused to prove the fact that he had no such mental state with respect to the act charged as an offense in that prosecution. So what he has to do? He has to disprove it. Unless the contrary is proved, like that. Unless he proves absence of mens rea. So he has to prove the burden is shifted to him. Now see subsection 2. For the purposes of this section, a fact is said to be proved only when the special court believes it to exist beyond reasonable doubt and not merely when its existence is established by a preponderance of probability. See, what is the effect of the decision of the constitution bench in Sanjay's case? So, this absence of this mens rea has to be proved by evidence which is beyond reasonable doubt. So, proof beyond reasonable doubt. So, the preponderance of evidence, the probability, etc., is not applicable in protection of children from sexual offences act. That has been taken away. I think nobody has challenged its validity so far. Now, what is the mode of discharging this burden of proof? This reverse burden. The first decision that is that may be taken notice of is Kundalal Rallaram versus Custodian Evacuee Property, AER 1961 Supreme Court 1316, a three-judge bench decision. The case was under Negotiable Instrument Act, Section 118, came for interpretation, The facts were this: everything was proved by the plaintiff, but he did not produce his account books to prove the transaction. He admitted that there is an accounts book maintained, is an accounts maintained by him, but he did not produce it. The Supreme Court held that there is an Indian habit of withholding documents which would prove the party's case on the ground that the opposite side did not demand me to produce it. So unless the opposite side demanded me to produce it, I was not bound to produce it, was the difference. The Supreme Court held that, no, it is not so. Because if a party suppresses a document which would be sufficient to prove his case or which would unflinchingly prove his case, it is his burden to prove it. And if he does not prove it, the inference is that if it is produced, it would be against him. An adverse inference has to be taken. This is what the three-judge bench of the Supreme Court in AER 1961 Supreme Court 1316 held. So it further held that the defense can, the opposite side can, rely on the weakness of the prosecution case, the facts brought out in the evidence of the prosecution itself or the other party itself, circumstance of the case, the probabilities and presumptions. So a presumption in favor of a party may be sufficient to disprove the presumption raised by reverse burden clause in favor of the other party. So a presumption in favor of one party may be rebutted by the presumption in favor of the other party. This has been followed in all the subsequent cases, in criminal cases also. AER 2006 Supreme Court 3366 Narayana Menon's case. AER 2006 Supreme Court 3366. AER 2010 Supreme Court 1898. AER 2012 Supreme Court 2795. A question may arise whether the prosecution can rely on a presumption under Section 114. In support of his case that the procedure prescribed by a statute was followed. So the illustration G says that there's a presumption of regularity of performance of official act, judicial act, and etc. So can the prosecution rely on it to prove the action? The contraband which was seized by the investigating officer was packed and sealed, or the sample was taken in accordance with the provisions of the statute. This was considered by the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court held that in the cases under draconian statutes, or where this this reverse burden process are there, the prosecution cannot rely on the general presumption of 114 in support of its argument that the procedure was complied with. The Supreme Court in Naresh Kumar versus State of Himachal Pradesh, AIR 2017, Supreme Court 3859, held, in the stringent nature of the provisions of the Act, the reverse burden of proof, the presumption of culpability under Section 35, and the presumption against the accused under Section 54, any reliance on Section 114 of the Evidence Act in the facts of the case can only be at the risk of a fair trial to the accused. So it is not permitted. Strict proof is necessary as to the procedure adopted by the investigating officer or the person who detected the offense. That was followed in Hanif Khan alias Anu Khan versus CBI, 2019, 4 RCR criminal 250. That is a Manu SC 1498
2019. It is also reported in SEC online, sir. 2019
SEC online is there. SEC online is there. Right.
SEC online, SC 1810, sir.
Yes, right.
2019.
Yes. SEC online is there.
1810, sir.
The other journal has reported it.
Yes, sir.
Now, when there is a prevention, there is a presumption in favor of the prosecution, which can be disproved by the accused by another presumption, what will be the result of the case? So one presumption in favor of one party, there is a contrary presumption or presumption which would disprove the earlier presumption in favor of the other party, then what is the result? Because we have already discussed this Kundalal Rallaram case, three judge bench decision. Promissory note is executed, presumption of passing of conservation is there on 118A. But the plaintiff did not produce his account book. He admitted that he maintains an account. And the Supreme Court held that the presumption is that, the inference is that, if it had been produced, it would have been unfavorable to him. So that presumption 114 disproves the presumption 118. So when there is a presumption versus presumption, it is just like a case of conflicting evidence. So when there is a conflicting evidence, who would fail? The party on whom the initial burden lies. So in such cases, even though we can say that the principle of initial burden disappears after the trial started, this is a classic example where that is important, because one inference disproves the other inference, and that is against the plaintiff. So that can be easily disproved by another presumption. You can also go through 2007, 6 SEC 7-1. So this is actually the general principles regarding burden of proof. And we can, I may say that in all the new generation statutes, that is the statutes which have been enacted in the last 10 years, one decade, that the legislature is more inclined to incorporate these reverse burden costs, making the prosecution work very easy. Maybe there may be practical difficulties in proving these facts, but that trend does not appear to be good. Without any discretion, prudence, they are doing it. They are incorporating these clauses in every statute now. See, this is 30 of this protection of children from sexual offenses. Accused is helpless now. Section 29.
Sir, and
yes.
Sir, initially, sir, in the light of the 69th Law Commission report, they introduced it in Customs Act, Income Tax Act, and other acts.
Right.
It was
right.
A culpable mental state. Now, the other crimes they are
doing it. Because yes, in those cases, everything is done in secrecy. And it is very difficult for the prosecution to get this evidence. It's difficult to prove it. So it is it was a rule of necessity.
Yes.
But now, invariably, in all cases, they are incorporating this provision.
Yes.
Yes.
So right, sir.
All new generation statutes have these clauses. You take all all these statutes. So now these are the general provisions. The other are statutory provisions. We may not get time. It's already 1 hour. But I will say that 106 also is necessary to be referred to. 106. When any fact is especially within the knowledge of any person, the burden of proving that fact is upon him. So can the prosecution rely on? We have seen this ticket bus traveler. We have seen the lady practicing law without enrollment. Can the prosecution rely on section 106 and say that is a matter within the special knowledge? It is especially within the knowledge of the accused. So in my opinion, Section 106 has nothing to do with the initial burden, because initial burden can never shift. Section 106 arises in the course of a trial or inquiry. See the illustration. When a person doesn't act with some intention other than that which character and circumstance the act suggest, the burden of proving that intention is upon him. So that question arises after the trial only, or in the course of the trial only. Then second, a person A is charged with traveling on a railway without a ticket. The burden of proving that he had a ticket is on him. When is it? Only after the initial burden is discharged. Because in criminal cases, the prosecution has to always start the evidence. So 106 should not be misunderstood to mean that it affects initial burden, or the prosecution can say that the initial burden is on the accused. It never shifts. It never shifts. Then 112 also requires some mention. 112. The fact that any person was born during the continuance of a valid marriage between his mother and any man, or within 280 days after its dissolution, the mother remaining unmarried, shall be on conclusive proof that he is the legitimate son of that man, unless it can be shown that the parties to the marriage had no access to each other at any time when he could have been begotten. So take a case. A person in the service, a defense service, he went to his place of work and he returns after 3 years. When he comes back, he sees a 6-month-old child on the lap of his wife. And that starts or he files a legal action, initiates a legal action. His contention is that the child is not legitimate because he has not come to his native place for 3 years. My wife has got a child which is 6 months old. So can you say that Section 112 is attracted? 112 is attracted. How can it be disproved? See, normally if he has not come back native place for 3 years, that means his 6 month old, it is illegitimate. But here, what is the phrase? Unless it can be shown that. So he has proved that he has not come back. 112 presumption arises. And it is conclusive. Unless it can be shown that the parties to the marriage had no access to each other at any time when he could have, for he could have been forgotten. It is not that the party had at any time no access, but to each other, non-access to each other. So here the wife proves that though he did not come to my native place, our native place, I went to his place of work and we stayed there for about 6 months. And during that period, this child was begotten. So that is the meaning of Section 112. The emphasis should be on had no access to each other. Not one party had no access to the other. So if the lady proves that she actually went to his place of work and the child could have been begotten at that time, conception was at that time, that is sufficient to disprove the presumption or discharge the burden under Section 112. The other presumptions I cannot deal with because there are many presumptions. And I shall give you this Sanjay's case. Sanjay, this is 1994 5 ACC 410. 1994 5 ACC 410. Yes.
One aspect, sir. Now the Supreme Court, as you said, in 112 of the Evidence Act, yes, Supreme Court has held that DNA test would prevail, yes, over the presumption. That is,
but one aspect of the matter. Yes. Yeah, you are right. But the decision of the Supreme Court, except in one case, that is the 2001 case, 2001 Supreme Court, year 2001 Supreme Court.
Yes, sir. By just
that is Katie Thomas. Except in that decision, in all other judgments, the Supreme Court has not given a go by the Section 112. The Supreme Court has said that if a prima facie case is established, a prima facie case is established, then DNA test can be ordered. So the moment this accused appears or the opposite party appears, the other party cannot apply for direction to conduct a DNA test. He has to first establish a prima facie case. Prima facie case means what? There was no non-access to each other. That is the prima facie proved. As a routine matter, the court shall not order DNA test.
Yeah.
Except in this 2001, there is no reference to the earlier decision. And there is no mention about this prima facie case. Yes. Yes. So that is the law now. A prima facie case has to be proved before DNA test can be ordered. Yes. Now it is a question time, I think.
Yes, sir. The the first question is not in the nature of a question.
Yes.
But what he says is that, can you please throw some light on self-incrimination and CRPC 91 validity in such cases exercised by the prosecution on the side of the prosecution side on the accused? Self-incrimination, that is basically, it does not arise in the burden of proof, sir, but nonetheless, it relates to this confession and other matters.
Okay. I may be excused for 1 minute. Sir, I may be excused for 1 minute.
Sir.
Now disappear and reappear again.
Surely, sure. In fact, Justice Abraham Mathew and my association go a long way back. Justice Abraham Mathew was the director of the academy, he became the registrar vigilance, because usually registrar vigilance in the High Court is one of the senior most or the senior most district judge, because he will be conducting inquiry against all other judicial officers. So when he moved out of the academy, I came in his place. Nonetheless, we used to get his expert services even when he was the registrar vigilance, because it was indispensable. So that is what I want to tell you now. So that sir is back. You can put your questions.
Okay.
So shall I?
Same.
This, sir, the second question is...
Incriminating fact brought out.
Self-incrimination.
It may be either confession or an admission. Because confession is always an admission. It is an admission of the facts which constitute the offense, or the material facts which constitute the offense, or just admission of committing the offense. Yes, I murdered him. That is a plain admission, pleading guilty. That is a confession. So, but admission, all admissions need not be confessions. All confessions are admissions, but all admissions are not confessions. Admission amounts to a confession only when he admits his guilt or the facts which necessarily constitute the offense. This is what is defined by the definition given by the Supreme Court. Now, admission is, what is the difference between admission and confession? Confession. See, take a case where we know that under section 25, this admission to a police officer cannot be proved. A person in custody cannot be admission to confession to police officer cannot be proved. And 26, confession to anyone whilst the custody of the police officer cannot be proved. Exception is section 27. So there may be confessions or there may be admissions other than confessions. How it can be done? I shall just give you some examples. One. A person gives first information to the police to the effect that I was not at my home for 3 days. When I came back, I found the charred body of my wife. I don't know how she happened to die. So the police recorded the affidavit statement. He does not admit any, or he does not make a confession in it. No incriminating circumstances there. To that extent, no ingredient. But it was found that he is the murderer. The question is, can it be proved? Can the affidavit statement be proved? Whether it is incriminating or not? So here we have to make a distinction between admission and confession. Here the affidavit statement clearly says that the charred body is that of his wife. What does it mean? the prosecution need not prove the identity of the dead body. He admits the identity of that person. It is his wife. So that is an admission, but it does not come on, amount to a confession. But when we come to this, there is another case that is a person, the accused was taken to a doctor in the custody of a police.
Murli murder case.
Right. Yes. And to the doctor, this accused said that, I sustained this injury when in the case involving the deceased person, in the incident involving the dead person.
He was trying to administer poison at that time. Poison.
Facts, we need not mention it, it takes time. So what does it mean? It is not a confession. It is not a confession, but it is an admission. It is an admission because it suggests an inference as to a fact in issue or relevant fact. So it becomes admission that can be proved, though it is incriminating. But when we come to this FI statement, there is a difference. Suppose the FI statement contains, or it is a confession. The question is whether it can be dissected. The incriminating facts can be separated and the other admission part can be proved. FI statement. Take a case where this is the statement. I was drunk. Is it an offense? No. I was drunk. I was driving a car at a speed of 120 kilometers. It's no offense. It does not say that it is a public place. No. I could see a man on the road at a distance of 50 meters. No offense. I did not sound my horn. No offense. I made no attempt to stop the car. No offense. The car knocked down that man. No offense. But when you read it as a whole, what does it mean? It means confession. So you cannot separate a statement. You cannot separate a part of the confession statement, incriminating facts, and admit the other part in evidence. So this was so held in AR 1966 Supreme Court 119. So the question is whether it amounts to confession or not. Once it is found that it amounts to confession, then it is not admissible. On the other hand, if it amounts to admission only, it can be proved. There is nothing wrong in it. But we know that admission made to a police officer cannot be proved because of section 162 CRPC. That bar also is there. But a contrary view was taken in 1966 Supreme Court 119. I have already mentioned that is a 3-judge decision. But a contrary decision was taken in 1994, 2 ACC 467. It said that the non-confessional part is admissible, that incriminating part is admissible. But that is a 2-judge dependency. So, though we cannot say that a Supreme Court judgment is a peremptorium, in fact, it is peremptory. And the first decision, 66 Supreme Court 119, was reiterated in, that was followed in AR 1972 Supreme Court 922. So, incriminating circumstance, even if it is contained in the FA statement, if it only amounts to an admission, it can be proved. But if it is a confession, it cannot be proved. No part of it can be proved. Yes.
So then Kattikalu Ogadu is 11 judge benches also.
61 Supreme Court 1808. 11 gentlemen decision.
Yes, sir. The next question is it correct to say that the prosecutor has to prove its case beyond reasonable doubt despite having reverse burden under Section 29 of the POCSO Act?
Yes. So the Supreme Court has held that merely because there is a burden of reverse burden clause, the prosecution cannot say that cannot rest his case on probabilities. It has to prove beyond a reasonable doubt. That is absolutely necessary. Absolutely necessary.
So the next question is, it is usually said that the evidence should be produced before.
One minute. Yes.
The next question is, it is usually said that the evidence should be produced before charges or issues are framed.
Yes.
However, if we find something after charges or issues are framed, how can we convince the Honorable Judge to allow?
311. So 311 CRPC.
Yes, sir. DVC case.
That applies not only to examination of witnesses, but documents also. Because documents cannot prove themselves. Documents have to be proved through a witness. So examination of witness, the purpose is to prove a document. Yes, 311. And 311, the nature is that the first part is directory and the second part is mandatory. So if that is the court feels that is necessary to take a just decision, then it is the duty of the court to summon that evidence.
And the next question is, sir, human rights are equivalent to fundamental rights or not? That is, we have already discussed that.
Right. Human rights are natural rights. Natural rights are the fundamental rights. They are differently worded only the same concepts.
And the next question is, as per Section 14 of the Family Courts Act, court can receive evidence if it is useful in solving the case. No, it is not marked as evidence after giving enough time for defense to prepare. On these lines, there should also be something in civil and criminal that should also evolve. Just a thought, sir. That is what he has said.
There should be a framework.
Yes.
And this is actually what is wrong with this family court. There is no framework. In Malayalam, we say, "Vala illatha chattam."
Yes, sir. Yeah. Without...
There should be a boundary line.
Boundary line.
Cannot go.
Now, the other question. What is your view on rape based on false promise of marriage? These days, there are several such cases. That is another question. That is also a hypothetical question.
Hypothetical. In one case... the accused was accused belonged to Brahmin community. The victim belonged to a Harijan community. They had a sexual intercourse. The allegation was that he promised to marry her. The contention was that a mere promise to marry does not amount to this offense. It does not amount to rape. The Supreme Court held that when a person is aware that it is not practically possible for him to marry the victim and it is a false promise, because this happened in North India, not in Kerala. In North India, we know that it is impossible for a Brahmin boy to marry a Harijan girl. So the Supreme Court held that he was fully aware that he will not be able to marry her. So that was a false promise. Yes, there are situations like that.
Sir, in re-section 109, next question, the burden of proof in a suit or proceeding lies on that person who would fail if no evidence at all were given on either side.
102.
102. Yes. How does this work in a habeas corpus petition? That is the question, sir.
habeas corpus petition.
Strict rules of evidence law act does not apply.
No, does not apply in these writ petitions. They are actually the habeas corpus petitions are they are disposed of or in high court it is disposed of on the basis of affidavit. Affidavit, and you know that affidavit evidence act is not applicable to affidavit. It is an entirely different situation.
But sir, in the famous Rajan case, evidence was taken, sir. You remember?
Yes.
In next question is, in a criminal case, is the prosecution required to prove the guilt of the accused beyond reasonable doubt or beyond all reasonable doubt? That is
See, that is a term used by the legal profession. There is no such term used in this Indian Evidence Act or any other statute, except we have seen that section 30 of the POXO Act. Otherwise, that term is not found in the Indian Evidence Act. It is a question of proved. The definition of proved in this Evidence Act, it is the same for civil cases and criminal cases. But at the same time, the test is that of a prudent man. So when a prudent man, it is nothing but the judgment is nothing but the belief of that man, belief of the judge. It is the opinion of the judge, judgment, nothing else. So if I believe that, yes, it is the accused who murdered him, that is my judgment. That is my conclusion. Should be based on the matters before the court, that's all. But here my prudence demands me that the degree of proof that is required in a case where the accused has to be punished or sent to jail, the degree of proof should be more than the degree of proof that is required in a civil case. So that is how this concept of proof beyond reasonable doubt evolved. Otherwise, no statutory term. It is not a statutory term. It is nothing but the prudence, a rule of prudence.
Last question is, what is your view on section 111A? In a disturbed area, does it lead to presumption of offense? 114A is, sir, that gang rape, which was added in.
Presumption as to certain offenses.
Yes, sir. Gang rape cases.
After having an offense specified in subsection 2 in any area declared to be disturbed area under any enactment.
Yes.
Any enactment for the time being enforced, making provision for the suppression of disorder and restoration and maintenance of public order. The offenses referred to in subsection are the following, namely, etc. The presumption is that, and is shown that such person had been at place in such area at the time when the firearms or explosives were used at all from that place to attack or resist the numbers of any armed forces, or the forces charged with the maintenance of public order acting in discharge of their duties, shall be presumed unless the contrary is known that such person had committed the offences. This is because of the compelling circumstances. Because we know that whenever there is a disturbance in an area, especially in the case of war, wartime rape, it is an unwritten rule now. It is an unwritten rule, and the United Nations has taken notice of it.
Yes.
In its documents, there is a issue, it should not be done, except human rights, violation of human rights, etc. But here in our area, that may also happen. It may happen. It happens in some parts of North India also. So that presumption is raised only because of the compelling circumstances. It is a necessary rule because compulsion demands that there should be such a presumption. You know that when once this a girl was allegedly raped at police station in Maharashtra. Thereafter, this section was amended. So the presumption is, if a girl is raped in the custody of the police, then there is a presumption. So stringent provisions are there.
Absence of consent is presumed.
Presumed.
So these are the questions, sir. There are rest of the questions are all not relating to policy matters, so I thought I... so thank you, sir. Thank you for the fine time you spent with us.
Thank you very much. Burden of proof is on whom in POXO case in which woman filed against her husband on behalf... Yes. I could not read it. Okay.
Yes. So, summing up, today we have had a very good class on burden of proof. Actually, we have got a real explanation of what burden of proof means, both in civil cases and criminal cases. And also, what is the distinction between onus of proof and burden of proof? As you rightly said, onus of proof and burden of proof are two different things. And so far as civil cases are concerned, it is merely of academic importance when evidence is adduced in court. It is the sifting of evidence and balance of ultimately preponderance of probabilities that matter so far as civil cases are concerned. Of course, criminal cases, sir, has explained that burden of proof always rests on the prosecution. Even in the case where there are reverse burden clauses like the POXO Act, Income Tax Act, where culpable mental state is to be presumed. Now, I thank, sir, for a very excellent class today, illuminating all aspects of evidence law relating to this topic, a difficult topic, burden of proof and standard of proof. I thank you on behalf of Live Law, sir, and also my personal behalf. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, Mr. Harindranath, my close friend.
Yes,
we were together at the academy.
Yes, sir.
And we always stand on the same footing.
Yes, sir. Long association, sir.
Yes.